I'm Harriet Vance-Ball, Associate Professor of Medicine from McMaster University in Canada, and I'm pleased to have Professor Mamas Mamas, Professor of Cardiology from Keele University, to join me as we discuss our favorite clinical trials from ESC 2019.
Thank you.
So I'm going to start by asking you what you perceive as the most impactful clinical trial in coronary artery disease at this trial.
I mean, in my view, it's probably the COMPLETE trial. So the COMPLETE trial is a randomized controlled trial, randomizing patients with multivessel disease and STEMI to a strategy of either culprit-only revascularization or complete revascularization. And what the trial showed was almost 24% reduction in cardiovascular death MI endpoint. The interesting thing about this trial was that the benefit was seen both in complete revascularization in the inpatient or outpatient population up to 45 days, and it will really change how we treat these sorts of patients.
Who do you think the trial population is most applicable to, or who would you say the trial results are most applicable to?
I mean, when you do a randomized trial, you obviously recruit very healthy individuals, and it's very interesting to see that, you know, this trial was undertaken in large volume centers, and the average recruitment was only 7 patients. I think the bigger question to my mind is, you know, what do we do with the multimorbid frail patients? Will we have similar outcomes in these? Because of course, the risk of bleeding, the risk of complications is much higher. And so will the benefits still persist, or is there a potential that, you know, the risks of undertaking further stage procedures in this really higher risk population outweigh any potential benefits?
Okay.
I mean, there's been some really interesting heart failure trials as well. I mean, what did you think about the DAPA heart failure trial?
You know, it's probably the trial that will impact clinical care the most. It was a multi-center, multinational, randomized control clinical trial that recruited patients who had a clinical history of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. And unlike past trials with SGLT2 inhibitors, this one included patients who did not have diabetes. And past studies had shown that SGLT2 inhibitors as a class decrease the incidence of heart failure in patients with diabetes. And this trial sought to assess whether this class of medications could offer effective treatment for patients with heart failure. The primary endpoint was a composite of CV death, heart failure hospitalization, and heart failure urgent care. And the trial randomized patients to 10 milligrams of dapagliflozin or usual care, and found that the primary outcome was reduced by about 26% in patients who had received dapagliflozin. So it's a significant finding that shows that patients with heart failure and reduced ejection fraction benefit from this drug, whether or not they have diabetes. And, you know, the benefit extended to health-related quality of life, which was a secondary outcome, which is an important outcome that often does not get measured in clinical trials. So it gives us many reasons to consider this drug in patients regardless of whether they have a history of diabetes.
I mean, I guess, you know, the question that came to my mind is, who's going to implement, you know, the prescription of this drug? I mean, you know, dieticians in the UK or endocrinologists will often look after diabetic patients. They have a lot of experience in using these drugs. Now we're seeing a benefit in non-diabetic patients. So is it the endocrinologists? Is it the cardiologists? Is it the internal medics? I mean, what's your view?
You know, there's a variation in how healthcare is delivered across jurisdictions. I think this study gives pause to consider that all clinicians should consider the prescription of this medication. A majority of heart failure patients do not receive care from cardiologists. So to leave the prescription of this important class of medications to cardiologists would mean that implementation is delayed. I would encourage primary care physicians, internal medicine specialists, endocrinologists, and cardiologists as well as some of the subspecialists that provide care to patients, you know, nephrologists, for example, to be partners in delivery of best medical therapies to patients with heart failure. And, you know, it's important to note that patients with advanced kidney disease were excluded from the trial, as were patients with hypotension. So I would not offer this class of medications to patients with significant kidney disease or resting hypotension, and also refrain from prescribing it to patients who are volume depleted, as the drug has a diuretic effect.
Yes.
Did you have a second choice or second pick for coronary ischemia as a?
Yes, I think the ISAR-REACT trial is very interesting. I mean, you know, we've had, you know, this question now for many years in patients with acute coronary syndrome: what should we be using, ticagrelor or prasugrel? Both ticagrelor and prasugrel have class 1A indications for their use in acute coronary syndromes from the European Society of Cardiology guidelines. They've both been shown to be superior to clopidogrel in landmark clinical trials, you know, the Triton trial, the Plato trial. And so really there's the thought, you know, which one should we be using? You know, are they equivalent? And we published a paper around a year and a half ago using national UK data, which suggested that perhaps prasugrel had better outcomes in terms of 30-day and one-year mortality compared to ticagrelor in primary PCI. I think a very important finding of the paper was that there's very different practices in the UK. Some regions are using ticagrelor, some regions are using prasugrel. And so I think it really draws, you know, the attention, the need for a big randomized trial, and that's exactly what the ISAR-REACT trial was. It was an investigator-led trial, a single center, whereby they randomized patients with acute coronary syndrome, 4,000 patients, to ticagrelor or prasugrel, and they followed them up. And what the trial showed was that the patients treated with ticagrelor had a 33% increased risk of cardiovascular death and MI, and what there was no difference in major bleeding. So I think that's really going to change our practice in terms of, you know, which drug that we use for which patients. But I think the other important thing is that as cardiologists, we often think about having to pre-treat patients with antiplatelets. And of course, the trial indirectly assessed pre-treatment versus treatment of antiplatelets at the time of CATH. So ticagrelor was used pre-CATH, prasugrel was used at the time of CATH, and there's no difference in bleeding rates, but better outcomes with the prasugrel that was used at the time of the CATH. And so I think that sort of supports the notion that perhaps we don't need to be pre-treating these patients. And so it will be very interesting to see how the recommendations within guidelines change as a result of the ISAR-REACT 5 trial.
What were your thoughts on the risk reduction provided by prasugrel relative to ticagrelor? Yeah. It seems to be quite a dramatic risk reduction.
It is, and I mean, I had similar thoughts in our analysis of close to 100,000 patients where we saw a similar dramatic reduction. I guess in a number of studies where they've looked at platelet function testing, prasugrel is associated with more potent platelet inhibition much more rapidly than ticagrelor. Mm-hmm. I think there's clearly an issue with discontinuation of the drugs. The median time to discontinuation of ticagrelor was around 90 days, with prasugrel's 130 days. Mm. And we know from other studies that discontinuation rates, mainly because of side effects, are much higher with ticagrelor, especially shortness of breath. And I think finally, ticagrelor is a twice-daily medication. And so, you know, we know from the literature that there is always an issue around adherence with twice-daily versus once-daily medications. I thought Paragon was quite an interesting trial, perhaps for the wrong reason.
We can't leave this discussion without discussing Paragon. So this was another landmark trial presented at ESC this year, and it sought to answer the question: does sacubitril valsartan relative to valsartan alone improve clinical outcomes in patients with heart failure and preserved ejection fraction? So the trial recruited patients with an EF greater than 45%. And NYHA class 2 to 4 symptoms, and after a brief run-in period, randomized patients to either sacubitril valsartan or valsartan alone. And the primary endpoint was a composite of heart failure hospitalizations as well as CV death. And And there was much anticipation and some expectation that the intervention would improve clinical outcomes in a statistically significant manner. Unfortunately, the intervention was not entirely effective. The p-value was just over 0.05, and the hazard ratio was about 0.87. So there was a hint that it potentially is effective, but did not meet the pre-specified endpoint. And it might be because heart failure with preserved ejection fraction is a heterogeneous population. There were subgroup analyses that showed that patients with a lower EF and female patients showed benefit, whereas those with an EF greater than 57% and male patients did not derive benefit. So it certainly calls for further research to tease out whether males and females have different etiologies that explain heart failure with preserved EF, or perhaps the differences in range of what a normal EF is in females versus males, or perhaps their molecular mechanisms that account for differences, could explain this differential response.
I mean, will it change your prescribing practice? So will you prescribe Entresto in patients, in female patients, for example?
You know, there are a range of ways to answer that question, and I think if you're a purist, given that the primary outcome was neutral, you know, I would not prescribe the therapy to any patient based on subgroup analyses.
So are you a purist?
I am a purist, yes. How about you?
Yes, I guess I am.
Right. So I would withhold the treatment in this population of patients until we have further data. Perhaps it calls for a randomized clinical trial in female patients to see whether they would derive benefit from this class of medications.
Great.
Thank you so much for joining
me
for this segment. And we thank our viewers for joining us. And we look forward to our next discussion, perhaps at AHA.
Thank you.